Hi, my name is Heather Slesser with the Marathon County Extension Office. Today we are talking about the first part in our series on bull health and fertility. Our first part is on male anatomy. To truly understand bull health and fertility, you need to know the different components of the male reproductive system and what their function is. There are six major components to the male reproductive system: the spermatic cord, scrotum, testis, excurrent ducts, accessory sex glands, penis, and muscles for protrusion and erection or ejaculation. The first part of the system is the spermatic cord. The spermatic cord's main function is to connect the body to the testis, or the testis to the body. The spermatic cord is also responsible for holding the cremaster muscle and the pam piniform plexus, each of which we will talk about in more detail. The cremaster muscle is the primary muscle supporting the testis. The cremaster muscle creates a pumping action that facilitates blood flow and cooling efficiency within the testis. It is not responsible for elevating the testis during cold temperatures. It cannot maintain contractions for long periods of time, therefore it is not part of our cooling mechanism. The pam piniform plexus, the other item that is housed within the spermatic cord, is responsible for cooling the blood as it enters into the testis. The blood that is within the testis is 4 to 6 degrees cooler than body temperature. This heat transfer is necessary for proper spermatogenesis. The transferring of heat goes from the arteries to the venous blood and out through the walls of the scrotum. The picture shown here shows the interconnectedness of the arteries and the veins within the testis. There are many veins that circulate around the arteries that help dissipate that heat and allow the cooling effect that we see. The scrotum is a thermosensor and is responsible for sensing the temperatures that are affecting the testis. When the males experience elevated body temperatures or elevated scrotal temperatures, the hypothalamus detects this change and sends nerve impulses to the sweat glands. The sweating then allows the scrotum to be cooled by evaporative heat transfer. Therefore, the scrotum is also known as a swamp cooler because it is heavily populated with sweat glands, and it is effective at conducting heat away from the testis by evaporative heat transfer. The last function of the scrotum is to act as a protective sac. This sac keeps the testes safe from injury. It also raises and lowers the testis depending on body temperature. So when the animal is hot, the scrotum is lowered, allowing the testes to move farther from the body. During periods of cold temperature, when the testicles are cold, the scrotum holds the testes up close to the body, making sure that they can efficiently be warmed by the body temperature. This infrared thermogram shown in the picture is of a bull scrotum. It shows that there are elevated temperatures, testicular temperatures, closer to the body, and as we get to the base of the testis, we see that there are lower temperatures. This is an indication of the function of the pam piniform plexus and the cooling effect that we see. The testis is the main reproductive organ. It's a paired organ, meaning that there are two of them within the male species. Within the testis, we have production of spermatozoa, or sperm cells, hormones and proteins, and various fluids. The fluids that are produced within the testis serve as a vehicle in which spermatozoa are suspended and facilitates the removal from the testis. It is not the fluid that we see in the ejaculate. The seminal fluid is produced by accessory sex glands, not by the testis itself. Within the testis, the Sertoli cells are known as the governors of spermatogenesis. Each Sertoli cell hosts a maximum number of developing germ cells. Germ cells are what become our sperm. So, if the more Sertoli cells we have, the more sperm cells we will ultimately have. The excurrent duct system is the final stage for maturation, storage, and delivery of the sperm. The excurrent duct system consists of the efferent ducts, the epididymal duct, and the ductus deferens. The efferent duct is a tube that connects the testis to the epididymal duct, and it conveys newly formed spermatozoa and fluid into the epididymal duct. The epididymal duct, or the epididymis, is responsible for final maturation of the sperm and ultimately storage of the sperm. The ductus deferens is the tube that carries the mature sperm from the epididymal duct out through the urethra for insemination. So the epididymal duct is broken into three parts: the head, the body, and the tail. Within the head and the body, final maturation of the sperm occurs, and within the tail, we have storage of that matured sperm. Sperm located in the head is not motile, not fertile, and there is a cytoplasmic droplet located right below the head on the start of the tailpiece. The reason there is a cytoplasmic droplet is because the sperm wants to decrease its size. So during the final maturation stages, we lose part of the cytoplasm, decrease the sperm so that it is smaller in size. Within the body of the epididymis, sperm has some expression of motility, it has some fertility, and that cytoplasmic droplet has moved farther down the tail. At this point, sperm can be bound to oocytes or will bind oocytes if it is removed from the epididymis. Within the tail of the epididymis, we have fully mature sperm. It has full expression of motility, it has full fertilizing potential, and that distal droplet has moved even further down the tail. And the sperm in the tail can also bind an oocyte. Epididymal transmit time is the time required to transport spermatozoa from the head to the tail of the epididymis. Sperm stays 2 days within the head, 2 days within the body, and sperm is stored in the tail for 10 days. Sperm is ejaculated out of the tail on a continual basis so that we can keep fresh stores of sperm within that tail epididymis. The ductus deferens is the last part of our efferent duct system, and it transports spermatozoa to the pelvic urethra. As the sperm goes through the pelvic urethra, it meets up with fluids that are produced by accessory sex glands. So the accessory sex glands are responsible for production of the liquid portion of the semen. It is not required for fertility, but it is important for natural insemination. The fluid acts as the vehicle for sperm delivery. The penis is the copulatory organ of the male, and it is composed of three parts: the base, the shaft, and the glans penis. The base is the attachment point, or the point where the penis attaches to the animal's body. The shaft is the main portion and is the long stem portion of the penis. The glans is the specialized end, or the tip of the penis, that is responsible for excitation and ejaculation. It is the stimulation of the glans penis that is the primary factor initiating the mechanism of ejaculation. The penis in the bull is a fibroelastic penis, meaning that there is limited erectile tissue and it has a sigmoid flexure, or an S-shaped curve within the penis. This sigmoid flexure allows the penis to be retracted inside the body until erection occurs. When the male is excited, the smooth muscle of the retractor penis muscle is released, and that penis is allowed to extend outside the sheath of the animal. The penis has several erectile tissues within it, and it is stiffening of these erectile tissues that cause an erection. However, in the fibroelastic penis, stiffening occurs without significant change in diameter. So, erection occurs when there is relaxation of the retractor penis muscle and that sigmoid flexure is allowed to expand. There is also rushing of blood into the corpus cavernosum and the corpus spongiosum, the two erectile tissues within the penis.
Thank you for watching this video, and we hope you learned something.